I know that's ever regretted of trusting in Jesus Christ. Let's all stand. 657, a new name in glory. Let's lift it up on that first verse.
I just want to say,
you may be seated. What a joy to see each and every one of you tonight. We've got a wonderful service planned, and I'm glad you're here to take part of all of it. I, for one, got a nap this afternoon, and so I'm ready to go for all this time. No, we'll be a timely service like normal, but I did get a nap. I think I went more into like a coma than a nap. I mean, when you wake up and you got drool coming down out one side of your mouth, this whole side's numb, and then you can't remember where you're at, and what day it is. You're lucky I'm here. I almost just thought it was I was out for the week, but praise the Lord. Hope you got one as well. Unless you don't take them, if that makes you grumpy, then I'm glad you didn't. Now, somebody was telling me after church, oh, no, you're going to pay for that tonight. You won't be able to go to sleep. Well, I think it's a pretty good trade-off. I'll do something else tonight, I guess. But thank you for being in church tonight. We're looking forward to a good time. I'll introduce my good friend, Brother Finley Cutshaw, in just a moment. He pastors over on the other side of the state, and we're certainly thankful he's through our way, but I'll introduce him in just a little bit, but I want to say thank you for all that went on today. The Lord blessed us. We're so glad to have Brother Steve. He's somewhere. I saw him over here. Joined with the church this morning. Praise the Lord for that. And then we had a great crowd. We thank the Lord for the folks in the first service and then the ones at 11 as well. And so I oftentimes give that report. Sometimes we find extra people and you think, well, that's a strange thing. You find them around in the place. I mean, we find them on paper. We never find any. Stephanie usually tries to find people people on Monday, but we rarely ever find bodies. It's always just people in a class that didn't get counted. So I think there's 121 in the first service and 542 in the second. So we're thankful for God's blessings. And folks, that's really what it is. God is just blessing, and we're thankful to Him. All glory goes to the Lord, and we just want to give His name glory for that. Praise Him for that. There was 82 on the buses, and thank the Lord, bus workers, for bringing those 82 in, and we're grateful for what the Lord is doing. Thank God for all of that. Well, pray with me, if you will, that the Lord will bless us, and Brother Daniel will come give us a few announcements, keep us up to date on some things. Father, thank You for this day. Thank You for bringing us a good crowd this morning, dear Lord, just the first Sunday in August. And Lord, it's hard to believe for one thing, but then without a special push or anything, Lord, You just blessed us with a great crowd, and thank You for that. Thank You for the way You blessed our first service and second one, and dear Lord, now thank You for the chance to gather back together tonight. I pray that You bless as we get exposed to a wonderful mission agency. I pray that You bless Brother Finley. Thank You for bringing him our way. I pray, dear Lord, that You'd be in the message tonight, the rest of the singing, everything I ask, dear Lord, that we could give glory to You in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, as a church family, one of the greatest things that we can do is be active in reaching out to people and letting them know about the Lord, letting them know about our church. And so in just a couple weeks, we have the Appalachian Fair here in our area. And every year, it's an opportunity for us as a church family. If you've never had an opportunity to take advantage of it, I encourage you to this year. But we have a booth there that our church sets up, and then the Amazing Grace booth is there as well. And the focus of that is to share the gospel with each person that comes. And obviously, our church, that's our goal as well, though we have a slightly different approach at that. We just try to invite people and let people know about the church a little bit. And so if you'd be interested in working at the one of those fair booths, I want to encourage you to. You can see me after the service anytime, but there's a sign-up sheet out in the lobby for both of them, and you could find a time slot that would work for you and say, I don't know exactly what I would do if I went and signed up. Sign up. We'll have a training meeting here in just a couple weeks after or before an evening service for each one of them. But it's a great opportunity to try to get the gospel to people and to get the name of Buffalo Ridge into the hands of people so that they can know there's a church in the area and that we could try to make a difference in their lives. And so you sign up as you leave today. And then ladies, your Bible study books are available as well. I believe Miss Dora Smith will be available to get those to you after the service this evening. And so you see her in the lobby afterwards, and she'll help you get those so you can be ready for your Bible study here starting in just a few weeks. All right, Pastor.
Well, it's a joy to serve on a board with Brother Finley Cutshaw, and he pastors the Eastside Baptist Church over in Memphis, but he's not that bad because he really is from this side of the state, and he's from the Greenville area, and he's back over for a homecoming, but I do know that a lot of times we think, boy, that side of the state, it gets shaky. And so what we did was, We wanted to reintroduce him over here to the right side of the state. And so we've got some Dr. Enough in here. We've got Moon Pies from Chattanooga. We've got some from McKee Bakery down in outside of Chattanooga as well. And then we've even got some chips in here from Abingdon, Virginia. So Brother Finley, why don't you come? Take this with you. Take this to your wife if you don't mind, and she'll keep it for you. So he pastors the Eastside Baptist Church, and as I said, he and I serve on a board together. But along with the duties there at the church, they also have a mission sending agency, and it's a blessing. I want to come set that up a little bit, and then we're going to see a video about it. And I just wanted us to be aware. You know, I serve with BIMI, and they're doing a great job. But I'm interested in everybody that's keeping a traditional stand on the Word of God and keeping a traditional need for getting the gospel to the ends of the earth. And so I thank God for Brother Finley and the ministry that's out of the church there. You'll learn a little bit more about that. But I want him to come and introduce himself and his family. And thank you, brother, for coming to church tonight.
Amen. I love your pastor. He's a fine man. I appreciate his friendship. And he's a blessing to have on the board of the TIBRL. And I hope you'll pray for that ministry. I'm not here to represent that, but I always like to put a plug in for it when I have an opportunity. Tennessee Independent Baptist for Religious Liberty. And I'm very thankful for that and thankful for that ministry. And I'll tell you what, folks, we need it more now than ever before in our history. We've got to have somebody in the state capitol saying what we believe out loud. Amen. And so I hope y'all will pray for that ministry. Pray for Brother Aaron Snodderly as well. Now, very quickly, I'll shift gears here and say that I am here on behalf of Fundamental Baptist Worldwide Mission. You know, John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The problem is, most of the world hadn't heard about his son. And that's true today, just like it was many years ago. And so there's enough need to go around to have more than one mission board and more than one church involved and more than one missionary being sent out. Amen. And you know, God had one son and he made him a missionary. I wonder if we have any sons that we'd be willing to pray that God will make them missionaries. There's a need in this world that is beyond our understanding. I don't know if you've ever been out of the country. God's allowed me to travel several places, different times over the years, and the need is great in the world. Now, I will say the need is great here in America as well. And so we want to plant as many churches, and we do have church planters with our mission board as well as missionaries being sent out. And I won't say a lot because the video really tells the whole story, but the reality is that we're about planting churches. That's the biggest aspect. That's really our focus as a mission board. And we want people to be out there planting churches and getting more churches established so that those churches can do that same thing. And we're seeing that as well, as I'm sure you have heard from some missionaries that are doing the same thing as well. I'm always surprised at how God will use one man to make a difference in a place. I'll give you one example. Missionary Yuri Martinez, who's a dear friend to our family. We took him in kind of like one of our adopted kids. He was from Honduras. He came to America illegally. He did, but he self-deported. And before he self-deported, he went and talked to the IRS, found out how much money he owed in taxes and paid those taxes before he left the country. An amazing individual. And he went to Honduras, his home country, and he established a church there. And now he has started a second church. He has a man out of his church that had to take a church in Guatemala that an American missionary had started and had to come home. Now that young man in Guatemala has planted another work in the mountains of Guatemala. Do you know the mountains of Guatemala have mountains in Guatemala? It's pretty mountainous already. But anyway, it's an amazing thing. And it's the New Testament principle being worked out in the lives of others. And our job, our desire, is to help as many pastors and churches and missionaries as we can get that job done. Now, I will tell you a couple things. There's some cards at the back. This is basically a prayer card. There is a little scan, a QR code on there if you know how to do that. If you don't, find somebody that's under the age of 30 and they can show you how to do it. A four-year-old can show you probably. You know how they are these days. But this will tell you a little bit about our ministry and just be a reminder. Maybe you could tuck it in your Bible. Use it as a bookmark. But please pray for Fundamental Baptist Worldwide Mission. Pray that God would send forth laborers and that he'll send the ones that we can help to us. You know we're not going to be able to help them all, but there are some that we can help. And then we have what's called the Annual Institute of Missions. If you have any interest in missions, it's a one-week training course. I'd love to have your pastor come over sometime. Sometimes we just have pastors that come and they're there with us and they go through that just to see what we're all about. But it's an in-depth training course, good for anybody that's considering missions. Now, I got to do one more thing and then I'll sit down. Y'all can see the video. But I have greetings from Pastor David Fox there in Greenville, Tennessee. I know he used to be on staff here. Brother Fox is such a fine man, and literally God used him to rescue my home church, Eastside Baptist Church, there in Greenville, Tennessee. And he's doing a tremendous job. They had their 40th anniversary today, and I preached there this morning. We had one man saved, praise the Lord. So y'all pray for Brother Fox, and he just wanted to say hello from Greenville there and let you know he loves you and he's praying for you as well. God bless you, and we'll see the video.
Fundamental Baptist Worldwide Mission was founded in 1985. When the mission was founded, it was founded on three basic convictions that we still hold to and practice today. The first of those convictions is that we believe that God pleases and plans to do all that he does in and through the local church. Fundamental Baptist Worldwide Mission is a ministry of Eastside Baptist Church in Memphis, Tennessee, where Finley Cutshaw is our pastor.
When God led me to Eastside Baptist Church in 2011, I was thrilled with the opportunity to come alongside Dr. Ernest Gambrell and work with Fundamental Baptist Worldwide Mission to get the gospel to the regions beyond. The focus of this mission has been and continues to be the establishment of local New Testament churches. Fundamental Baptist, Eastside Baptist Church, and other local churches and their pastors that have partnered with us are seeing New Testament missions-minded Baptist churches planted throughout the U.S. and around the world.
Our second conviction is pastors are in charge of the Great Commission. Any missionary that affiliates with Fundamental Baptist Worldwide Mission, he must be sent out by an independent Fundamental Baptist Church. He must be authorized, and his pastor's church must commission him in writing to do missionary work through Fundamental Baptist Worldwide Mission.
The home office of Fundamental Baptist Worldwide Mission is here to assist churches in sending their missionaries around the world. We facilitate the support of dozens of missionary families that comes in from over 2,000 different churches. The home office maintains a database of thousands of churches to help missionaries while they're on deputation and furlough. The home office offers help to churches and missionaries, providing discipleship materials, books, and studies on missions in the areas of New Testament church planting, training new believers, faith promise, deputation, and furlough. We daily help with governmental paperwork, banking, communication, and transportation needs of the missionaries, and supply expertise that individual churches may not have. The office is available on a 24/7 basis. The Mission Board handles all the income for the individual missionaries sent in by supporting churches and individual supporters. Additionally, we monitor the ever-changing laws and guidelines applicable to the missionaries to ensure the best and most reliable accountability and distribution of the funds. We do not charge our missionaries a percentage or a fee for any of the services that we perform for them. We believe that it's very important that the missionaries receive 100% of the support. We're thankful for the opportunity that we have to train missionaries and be a part of their ministries all around the world. We spend much time in teaching and instruction. We have custom modules by which we give instruction to the college students in preparing them for the mission field. We're also in many Christian schools preaching and teaching and doing chapels and missions emphasis times, and hold missions conferences as well as missions emphasis weekends in many local churches around the country. One of the most valuable aspects of the ministry, I believe, is the annual Institute of Missions. It's held every year in the month of June at Eastside Baptist Church. We have 25 plus hours of class time during the week. We cover many different aspects of missions during that week, from the matter of the will of God and the call of God, missions deputation preparation, language study, much things that are done on the field, especially with the aspect of church planting and leadership training.
When I felt the Lord directing me into missions, my biggest question was, how do I prepare for that? I was shocked by how much material was covered, from the financial aspect to the actual planting of churches, and how you do that, and how to not do that.
Sometimes when you go to the mission field, you have lots of difficulties. But when you hear the other ladies tell what they go through, and it's the same thing as what I go through, their testimonies encourage me.
Since 1985, Fundamental Baptist Worldwide Mission has been called upon by hundreds of local churches to assist and serve their missionaries. Through the years, the staff of FBWWM has worked together with missionary families in dozens of countries. Today, FBWWM helps sending churches and their missionaries and planting churches on six continents. It is our constant prayer and desire to assist in the pioneering of new fields of service. Would you go and take the light of the glorious gospel to people who are in darkness?
The third conviction we have is that we believe that God would have us to live by the faith principle. We do not make any charge in any way for any missionary that affiliates with Fundamental Baptist Worldwide Mission. We are supported by independent Baptist churches, and we thank God for that. God's been good to provide all of our needs.
Would you pray about partnering with us in three areas? First of all, I'd like to ask every believer to join us in praying daily that God would send forth laborers into his harvest. Secondly, I would like to ask pastors and their missionaries to consider us in helping them get to the field. And finally, I'd like to ask pastors to pray about making our home office a part of your mission support. I pray daily that God will send forth laborers into his harvest field. And it's my desire that he would use us at Eastside Baptist Church and Fundamental Baptist Worldwide Mission to help get those laborers to his field.
We at FBWWM thank the Lord for the privilege to serve churches in spreading the gospel and planting new churches around the world.
God's great love, how he died for men and rose again, is renewing my hope above. Jesus sent the gap between his holiness and my sinfulness.
Appreciate the work there of the mission, and there's one project that they're working on now, or they need to be working on, and that's redoing their mission apartment. I think we have a couple pictures of that just to give you a little bit of a visual. They've got one that they're able to help missionaries on the furlough or deputation as they come through and able to be a blessing to them. Of course, you know the Lord allowed us to redo our ministry house over here, and we've been able to be a blessing to many different missionaries. And so I was telling the deacons the other night about it, and we wanted to do something, wanted to present it to the church. I'm going to ask Brother Danny to come and just change things up just a little bit, but ask Danny to come and let you know what I and the deacons would like to recommend to our church to do so we can be a blessing to the mission agency over there.
The pastor and the deacons recommend that we give the Fundamental Baptist Worldwide Mission of Eastside Baptist Church in Memphis, Tennessee $5,000 toward the renovation of their mission house and support of their mission work. This will come from the mission fund, and I make this a motion.
Well, we like to do this because, as you heard in the video, they don't charge their missionaries the percentage of fees that they often do. There's no charge to the missionaries, and then this money will help give a better place as missionaries come through. And, you know, one of the great expenses of missionaries as they travel is lodging. And oftentimes they'll get a church will put them up on the Monday, or rather the Saturday night into Sunday into Monday. But then if they don't have a meeting till Wednesday, then it's a great, great blessing to them to be able to have a house or apartment as this is to stay in, and until they can go to the next meeting on Wednesday, or you know, as the week would go forward. So it's just a great ministry they have, and I'd love for our church to be a part of that. And so they'll use that very wisely as they redo that. and they have needs for the mission house or mission apartment. So with that being said, that's a motion that me, the deacons and I, we put forth. So we would need somebody to second that. If you like, Brother Larry Stover seconds that. And this would be money going to a great cause, because really what we're doing, it's not going to the foreign land, but it is. It's going to the people who are going to the foreign land. It gives them a place to just bed down and then go to their next station to try to raise funds to get wherever they're going. So Brother Larry Stover seconds that. All in favor, say aye. All opposed, same sign. All right, motion carries. Praise the Lord. Well, let's all stand together. Brother Dan's going to come lead us in hymn number 22. This wonderful, wonderful old song, How Great Thou Art. And would I challenge you, please, just to sing out and think about how the beauty of the song, but more important than the beauty of the song, the wonderful beauty of the God that we're singing about, How Great Thou Art. Oh, wait a minute. Danny Jenkins. Man, Danny always leaves me hanging on that. See, we had the Spirit of the Lord was just leading. All right, hold on now. So we need to close the business meeting. That's right. Thank you, Danny. It's not your fault. It's my fault. So we need a motion to close the business meeting. All right, Brother Bob Daniels, first time he's gotten to make one a long time. He makes that motion. Eugene Radford seconds it. All in favor, say aye. All right. Now, Danny, move on. Would you please? Boy, oh, boy, oh, boy. So thank you so much. That's a complete joke. We need to do that to keep it legal and all that. So let's sing now, though. Hymn number 22. And the same thing as I said before, think about the song. Sing, may we worship the Lord together as we sing, How Great Thou Art.
Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider my Jesus, I love thee. Let's lift this up also in adoration.
to our wonderful Savior. My Jesus, I love Thee. I know Thou art mine. For Thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious
about a city God had prepared that a man could run to when he found himself in trouble at a time of great despair, fleeing from the one who sought his life. And there outside that city, he cried unto the keeper and asked if he could enter, for there he would find safety. Yes, God, he had made provision, a city of refuge for him. Condemned from the fall of man, I was bound by sin with the debt to be paid. But God, he cared for me, and on Mount Calvary the foundation was laid. And on the cross Christ stretched out his hand, a mighty gulf did span, and it bought my liberty. Now I can run to God's only Son. He is a city of refuge for me. And one day I ran to that city of refuge. Though guilty I was, I found shelter in the blood that he shed for me. I was condemned, but God, he showed me mercy. And on Calvary, my God built a city of refuge for me. And one day I ran to that city of refuge. Though guilty I was, I found shelter in the blood that he shed for me. I was condemned, but God, he showed me mercy. And on Calvary, my God built a city of refuge for me. and on Calvary, my God built a city of refuge for me.
Amen and amen. Thank God for that city of refuge, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Brother Peyton, for singing, Miss Carmen, for playing. We appreciate that. Well, we're going to get right into our preaching, our message tonight, Galatians chapter 6. We're going to look at verses 11, 12, and 13 as we continue through this book. And trust it's a blessing to you tonight, Galatians chapter number 6. And we'll look at verse 11 and 12 and 13. It's a joy again to just to get to be in the singing. And I think that God has just touched our service, and I'm so thankful that He has. A joy to get to help a mission agency, which in turn helps missionaries, and then get to sing together and fellowship together. And thankful for all of it. Galatians 6, verse 11. You see how large a letter I've written unto you with mine own hand, the apostle, God's using him to close up the letter here in the next verses. As many as desire to make a fair show in the flesh, they constrain, they urge you, they're trying to get you to do this, they constrain you to be circumcised. Of course, that outward act there, which they were all worried about because it showed that they were doing what the Jewish customs wanted them to in the law. Only lest they should suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. For neither they themselves who are circumcised keep the law, but desire to have you circumcised that they may glory in your flesh. I want to preach for just a little while about this section. I trust it's a blessing to us as we get into it. Father, be with us now as our prayer, and I pray that you'd meet the needs that are represented here tonight, and we'll thank you for what you do in Jesus' name. Amen. We know from other passages of Scripture, Paul probably had some sort of eye problem, and he alludes to it in a sort of a way here in verse number 11. You see how large of letter I've written unto you in my own hand. I had one professor in college, and he was past legally blind, and so it was hard for him to hold papers up to see, but he still served the Lord just like the Apostle Paul did here, and Brother John Lehner would just serve and do things, but he had to adjust. And so some of the writings that Paul had used, he was able to have somebody pen them for him. But he says, I've written this unto you with mine own hand. And so we come to this passage, and as we're getting to it, God is showing this people of Galatia why the circumcised, that's the Jewish people, that's the Judaizers, the ones that wanted them to behave in a certain way because it looked good, why those Judaizers were acting in the way that they were. And so as we look at these couple of verses, a few verses, I trust it'll be a blessing to you. I first want you to see in verse number 12 that the people wanted them to change for the wrong reasons. They wanted them changed for the wrong reasons. Change is good. God leads you to do something, as long as it's not against this book. But if it's above this book, and God, you said God wants us to do this for our family, I believe we ought to go to a certain conference, a certain jubilee, a certain whatever. That's great. God's led you and your family to go do that. But just don't come back and say, now everybody who doesn't do what I just did, you're a bunch of low-down, rotten scoundrels if you don't go to that week of camp meeting like I did. There's nothing wrong with going. And you may be wrong if you don't go because God put it on your heart. Just be like this. Somebody comes through and Brother Finley was given the promotion of the mission, and so somebody says, I've decided I'm going to do this for every missionary who comes through. I've got a certain gift, or I've got a certain this, or I've got a certain that. Well, praise the Lord. The Lord put it on your heart. You ought to do it. But just don't look down your nose at everybody else that doesn't do what the Lord led you to do in that certain specific area. So we see in verse number 12, these Judaizers, these people that want these new Christians to come along and do what they say. We see people want them to change for the wrong reasons. Look at verse 12. As many as they desire to make a fair show in the flesh. Anytime we try to make a show, we're in dangerous territory. But it goes on to say they constrain you to be circumcised. That's again to follow that under the law. Only lest they should suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. So these Judaizers wanted the Gentiles who were getting saved to come be circumcised so that those original Judaizers, those folks that were impressing upon them, so that they wouldn't get the anger thrown on them because of the Jews, because of these Gentiles who were coming in, messing up our religion. About like a church that says, boy, it's wonderful. They say it's wonderful to have new folks come in until some of those new folks, they don't understand some of the traditions, some of the things that you do. And then you've got people saying, boy, they're messing up the whole place. And so they were wanting these people to change, but not for the right reasons, not because God led them to do it, not because they were instructed from heaven, but instead so that they would look good to their friends. So in essence, these Judaizers wanted people to obey that law that they had been under for their own reputations, not for the benefit of the people that were getting saved. Can I tell you a secret? Brother Finley Cutshaw and myself, that we have to be careful that we don't do the same thing, not for circumcision, those different things, but in certain ways that we have to be careful as a pastor of a church. When guests come in, here a good friend comes in, and you want the church to be full, and you want it to be an exciting service, and you want all things to go forward and be bombastic. Why? For the glory of the Lord? No. Just so it can look like you got it all together. Now, don't look so pious at me. It's the same way at your house. We can live with mess and clutter everywhere through that house. But then when somebody comes, what do we do? All right, kids, you ain't got time to play. Get up there and do that. And your mom's going through the house and she says, well, forget about it. They just throw the whole bed out. We don't have time. No, it's just all going to go out. Those clothes are gone. Those closets, no. And you just shove everything in this clothes closet and you push it, push, push, and you hope to the Lord that nobody opens that up and you got everything exactly like you should. And then what happens when that person comes to the door and they ring the bell and you say, oh, come on in. Now it's a mess. I didn't have time to clean up. Liar, liar, pants on fire. You had time to clean up. Matter of fact, you did a deep clean. You threw half the stuff you owned out. And so that's the way sometimes a pastor wants it to be. He says, well, I want it to be a full house, not for the glory of the Lord, just so that the preachers in the area, as they come to revival, boy, look at that church. That's really going and blowing for the Lord. And that's the way these people were. They wanted these new believers to change, and they wanted them to do the things that they wanted them to do, not because Scripture said, but instead so they would look good. Religious manipulation, it's a horrible thing, and it happens in false religions, but it also happens in some quote-unquote good churches, and people get used sometimes as pawns or chess pieces just to make the leaders look good. I only have to say the name Jim Jones to some of the folks in here that were around back in the 70s, and that compound back in 1978, I believe it was, where that horrendous mass suicide at the instruction of that madman was taken up, just because people get religiously manipulated. You know, it's bad to be manipulated, whether it's for a business, whether it's for your own gain, or whether it's for religion. You know that God gets blamed for a lot of stuff, right? A lot of people say, oh, that's in the name of God. Well, God wouldn't be anywhere near much of the things that go on under the banner of religion. But here we see these people want them to change for the wrong reasons. But I want you to look on verse number 13. Not only do they want them to change for the wrong reasons, but they're not keeping the law either. Those that demand so much, they're not keeping it. Look at verse 13. For neither they themselves, they are circumcised. They got that part right, yes. They've been through that ritual. They've got that act taken care of. But neither those are themselves who are circumcised keep the law. So those that demand so much, they're not keeping the law either. So mark it down, these Judaizers, they weren't keeping the law in other areas either. They were just keeping the law in that one area. And you notice when, let me back up. Do you notice what it's so easy to squawk the loudest about? It's what you've already got taken care of. It's something in your life that you don't struggle with. You don't struggle with getting up in the morning. You just bounce out of bed at 4 or 5 o'clock, something like that. Then you get mad at everybody else and you say, wow, you lazy folks sleep all the way till 7 o'clock. You slept in? Well, that's just the way your weird clock works. The rest of us like to sleep a little longer than that. And it's easy to get down on somebody who naturally doesn't do it just exactly like you do. Well, Paul says that these folks that are demanding so much, they're not keeping the law either. Now, I told the Sunday school class I was in today that it's amazing here. Think if I'm not right on this. If somebody, not only in religion, but everything, if somebody does more than you, they're a fanatic. If somebody does less than you, they're lazy. If somebody keeps their car a higher level of cleanliness than you do, My eyes just spending too much time on it. If they look like they're farming in the floorboards, they do less than you do, that they're just lazy. They keep their lawn up to a, they don't let any one weed get in there. They're like Steve Smith was on our yard, and our yard's not gotten over us buying the house from Steve and Jeanette. So they don't let one weed get out in there. And you say, boy, that's just spending too much time on that. I ought to be doing something else with this time. But then you got somebody else, looks like a sea of yellow when those dandelions are out. Say, boy, he needs to get on that yard. Somebody else keeping gardening or exercise or whatever else. Do you know where the standard is in that? I am. Not me, whoever's making the statement. You are, whoever's making the statement. Oh man, they're spending too much time on that. According to who? According to how I would do it. They don't take enough pride in that area right there. According to who? According to the person that's staying that. And that's exactly what these Judaizers were doing. For neither they themselves, who are circumcised, yes, but they're not keeping the law in other areas. I hear people say, I live by the New Testament, not by the Old Testament. That's Old Testament. That's under there. And there's lots of ceremonial things that we don't do anymore. Thank the Lord. You can go eat shrimp if you want to. You can have all these different kinds of things. I get all that. But I wonder when people say, oh, I don't live by the Old Testament, live by the New Testament. You like to look at them and say, really? So now is that when Jesus says, like the Old Testament law said, thou shalt not kill? But I say, if you get angry, you've already killed in your heart. I'm wondering if they're following that Old Testament law where Jesus said, it says, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say, if you look upon a woman of lust, you've already committed adultery in your heart. And so he goes not only in the Old Testament, he brings it forward. Yes, he's right. He brings it right in the New Testament, but he brings it and strengthens it from where it was. Mark it down. Legalism, though, sounds good to certain people. And it usually sounds good to the people in the area that they've already got sewn up. You get on the things that they have struggled with, and then they'll say, oh, liberty, liberty, liberty. Not that it's commercial, liberty, liberty, liberty. I'm talking about, they'll say, liberty, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. You thought I was making a commercial there for a little bit. We get on something that they don't have sewn up or that they struggle with, and then they want a lot of grace. And they want, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. Give me time. But boy, if we're not careful, and it's not just them, it's us. If there's some area that we don't struggle with very much, it's very easy for us to be judgmental in that. Very easy for us to be too harsh on somebody. And that's exactly what these people were saying. And so Scripture says, they're not keeping the law either. But boy, are they coming down hard on you on that area that they do have time, have settled or sewn up. Guy comes down the neighborhood street 40 mile an hour. I'll lock that fella up. Throw the book at him. And they shouldn't be doing that. It's unsafe. Children be playing out there. But it's amazing that same person doesn't want the state trooper to be too harsh on them when they're going 79 out here on Interstate 26. So we see that those that demand so much, they're not keeping the law either. Let me give you the last one here. Look at the end of verse number 13. I told you they demand so much, but they're not keeping the law, but they want you to make them look good. Verse number 30, but they desire to have you circumcised. Again, go through that Old Testament law ritual. They desire to have you circumcised. Why? The end of the verse tells that they may glory in your flesh. They want you to do something so it makes them look good. But the truth is, we're not supposed to work or serve or be circumcised in this passage or be baptized or teach or stand up or sing or whatever to be seen of men or to the applause of men or so other people would get glory, but all that we do are supposed to be unto Him. Whether therefore ye eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. But these folks wanted themselves to look good, and they thought these little converts coming, these Gentiles, they're not Jews, and so my Jewish friends are really going to be watching out for me, making sure that I'm holding the line on them, so you guys better go do these things. Why? So that you'll be in their good graces? No, so I'll be in their good graces. I noticed this about parents as we've gotten the opportunity to talk with hundreds of them, I guess, over these years. Do you know how most what level many parents want their children to obey, to live right at? Many parents that I meet, They want their children to be godly enough just not to embarrass them. I mean, they don't want, like Brother Finley said, they don't want them to go to the mission field. They don't want them to be sold out. They don't want them to go be a bus captain, and that's going to take a lot of time. They don't want them to go full-time, go to a Bible college and go pastor a church somewhere. Well, that's kind of fanatical. Oftentimes, parents, and I hope we don't have too many of those, but they want their kids to live godly enough just to not embarrass them, not cause them any great, oh my goodness, kind of moments. They want them to make them, the parents, look good. Could I challenge you as your parents? You let God take care of your reputation. You just do what's right for your children. Honor God, raise them for His glory. Let God take care of your reputation. That's what these Judaizers should have done. I think about this just as a little closing thought. I've always wondered about this when we've got this look and they say they may glory in your flesh. I've always wondered, sometimes we'll say we're proud of somebody, yet your pride is wrong. And I know of a pastor, he got reprimanded by somebody in his church. You shouldn't say you're proud, that's sin. He said, well, I'm grateful for him too, then. And so regardless of whatever you say, I don't care which term you use, I think we understand. We say, well, we're really proud of that young man. But whatever we use, let's glory in the Lord and the decisions and the actions that people do, not for your sake, not for my sake, not for a parent's sake, not for these Judaizers' sake, but for the glory of God. I'd mentioned that little phrase before. We used to do it in Bible school. Why do you do the thing, or used to say it in Bible school, why do you do the things you do, and who do you do them for? Do you do them for the praise of men, or do you do them for the Lord? Could I challenge you to make sure your life is spent doing what you do for the Lord? Now, don't mind some loudmouth preacher coming and getting on your case if you're not doing enough. Sometimes that's my job as the pastor. But when you do get convicted of it, don't do it because I said so. Don't do it just to look good in front of me. Don't do it to look good in front of your fellow church members. Whatever we do, be that we had a good breakfast yesterday, Eugene cooked. We've had so many people serving today in different classes. We've had great singing. We've had great playing. We've had all of these different things. But I hope that whatever went on, I hope this Sunday, like I pray every Sunday, happens from here on. I pray that it is done from the heart of people that want to please God and not please men. We've got enough men pleasers. We need to be God pleasers. Father, bless us now is our prayer. Thank you for this time to be in your book. And Lord, I pray that your book would be in us always. And I pray that this little message would instruct us, dear Lord, to remember, why do we do what we're doing? May we have a different outlook on it. May we have a different motivation. May we do it for the praise of God, not for the glory of men, and we'll thank you for it all. Our ladies are going to begin to play, and if you're able to, I'm going to ask you to stand together with us. As God speaks your heart, I invite you to come. Maybe you've been one of those ones doing things for the praise of men. And I tell you, it gets me sometimes. I have to be careful, I tell you. And if that's you, would you make a vow to the Lord? Lord, help me keep my eyes on you, not worry about what other people are doing or thinking, but instead, may I glorify you. Maybe it's some other need you have tonight and you'd like to come and pray about it, then the altar's open for you. Brother Daniel's right down here in front. Maybe you're here today and you're saved and you're baptized and you'd like to join Buffalo Ridge Baptist Church. You'd like to come present yourself for that. Would you step out and come? Maybe you've never followed Christ in baptism, but you need to be. That's just something the Lord has shown you that you need to do. That's the first step of obedience after a person gets saved. You'd like to come present yourself for that. Would you step out and come? And then you're here tonight. Maybe you're not sure that you're on your way to heaven. You've been living a life trying to do what's right in the eyes of men. You've been living trying to do what you should. But you see tonight that no matter how good you live, you can't live good enough. All are sinners, the Bible says, and we all come short of the glory of God. If that's you tonight and you realize that I'm not saved, I'm in trouble with the Holy God, I need to be born again, would you step out and come? Thank you so much. You may look this way. Well, it has been a joy to be in the house of God all day today. And I trust that the Lord has done a good work in your heart. I'm so thankful for what He's given us here at our church. And every Sunday I feel like unworthy to be pastor and unworthy to be here. But it's just a joy to get to serve together with all of you. And it's a wonderful thing. I'm going to ask Brother Finley, if you don't mind, to slip back to the table. He's got a table back there. He's got a few books by Brother Hembrell that is the president of the mission. Maybe you'd be interested in that. Also, some cards back there that just a reminder to pray for the mission. And I appreciate you getting to meet him as well. Don't hold it against him. He's from Memphis. He isn't really. He's from over here. He's one of us. So we thank God for him. But you tell him you're praying for him in the mission field over there. And we're thankful that he's here. Hopefully you get by to see him. I'm going to ask Brother Jeff Wheels, if you don't mind, to come to the pulpit and pray for us as we dismiss. And as he comes, you pray one for another. And let's pray that God would put his hedge of protection around us as we go throughout our week, and be a blessing to each other as you go out, and hopefully you'll get to talk to a few people who you haven't talked to. And once you continue to pray for Miss Sherry Shadden, she got home the other day, but you know she had that fall and bruised up her eye really bad, that around her eye, broke that eye socket. Keep her in prayer, and others were lifting up in prayer as well, and so I challenge you. Thank you for that. But Brother Jeff, pray for us, would you please? Thank you.
Dear Heavenly Father, what a great day it's been in the house of God. We thank you for the challenge of the Word of God here to live for you and serve you.